Thank you, Tom, and thank you to the Allen Public Library for having me. Such a wonderful opportunity to be here. This is an incredible library, and I'm really excited to share my story with you. I've included some visuals for you sort of along the way to give you a little bit of a background of my life. But the first thing I actually wanted to do before I talked about my story was talk to you about the book writing process and sort of the why I wrote that book, because I get the question a lot. So I thought I would sort of get that out of the way. I wrote the book because I wanted to shine a different light on national security and law enforcement. And I was sort of always raised that if I didn't like the narrative about something, you know, do something to change that narrative. And so I felt that writing a book would be sort of the best way to do that, writing about my experiences. I have had a lot of different experiences, and the way that I came to the career that I ultimately did is a bit unusual. I got an agent, but it took me about two and a half years to sell my story to Macmillan Publishing, who graciously and amazingly took it on. The other sort of technical thing I want to talk about is if you have the book currently, or if you plan to get the book, what you will notice is there are black lines throughout, and those are called redactions, and they're actually not for show. Those redactions and the way that you see it in my book now is the result of 5 different rewrites. When you leave the CIA, you sign something called a non-disclosure agreement. And what that means is anything you write, you'll submit to something called their publications review board. They'll review it to make sure that it does not give away any national security secrets. And then they send that back to you. When I got it back on its first pass, I would say a good 4 or 5 chapters were completely blacked out in their entirety. And obviously that's not going to make for an intelligible book. So then I had to rewrite it, send it back, rewrite it, send it back, rewrite it, send it back. And that took 4 or 5 times. The things that were redacted were not the things that I expected to be redacted. There were some chapters, and if you read my book, and I will talk about that a little bit more right now just a bit, the chapter called The Vault, I really didn't think would make it in at all. That program is still actually classified by the CIA, and it is in the book. Parts of it are redacted, but not the whole chapter. The reason, they will not tell you why they've redacted things, but I figured it out through, I guess, my spy investigative skills. The reason that things are being redacted was because when I traveled to different countries, when I was at the CIA, I did not travel as Tracy Chandler, which is my maiden name. I traveled under alias. And I really didn't put 2 and 2 together, but the reality was Tracy Chandler had never visited those countries. And I was providing way too much locational information in some of the chapters, and that's what they were redacting. And so once I figured that out, I was able to sort of work the system. And by its 5th pass, my editor had decided that it was going to be published with the redactions that you see now. She felt it was intelligible. So they're not for show. And it did take me about 5 times to get it to sort of the point that you see it at now. A lot of people like to tell me that they try to guess where I was in certain locations. But I really had to take all the locational information out. So I want to sort of just give you a background of my life and sort of how I got to where I got. So about me, this is just a background of sort of what I do now. I'm going to talk about each position sort of more in depth. I started at the CIA as something called a staff operations officer. The CIA is divided up into different divisions, if you will. There is the Directorate of Intelligence, and they analyze intelligence. I was very unqualified to be in that directorate. Most of them have PhDs in their area of studies. I was coming with a bachelor's in history. They write a lot of the analytical reports, and they're just incredible at what they do. The other large group is what we call the DS&T, or the Directorate of Science and Technology, and that's where sort of our engineers, the people that make the gadgets, Q, I guess, if you will, if you've seen the James Bond movies, that's where those people sort of fit, again, not probably the best place for me. And then the next one is the Directorate of Operations, and that's where I was. And that's where I guess the spies live, the collectors of human intelligence. And then even within that, we're further broken down. And so I was a brand new assignment called the Staff Operations Officer. When I had come to the CIA, they were in the midst or had just had finished reorganizing. They used to be in sort of very territorial divisions, you know, the Russia house, the Western European countries, the Latin American countries. It was very much like that. But I think at that point, the world was changing. There were counterproliferation issues, there were counterterrorism issues, there were things that were spanning different countries. And so they had developed something called centers, which I know now we're really familiar with. But back in 2000, when I started, the world was a very different place. And so they needed folks who were not able to just work in one country. They needed people to sort of work and be more flexible around the world. And that's where staff operations officers fit in. So that's what I was. And then I was assigned to a center, which is the counterterrorism center. And I'll go into that in a little bit. The next thing that I did after that was I was a special agent at the FBI. I feel like that's a little more self-explanatory because we see so much of it in pop culture. So, you know, as a special agent, you're assigned to different squads, and I'll talk about the squad that I worked on in a little bit. After that, I've been a teacher now for the past 14, 15 years. I've taught both in public schools, in private schools, and now I am an adjunct professor at TCU, and I teach criminal justice. So I'm really excited about that. I'm excited to sort of share my information about that from a woman's perspective as well. So I'm really looking forward to this next semester. Okay, so I sort of just put up a bunch of pictures that described my, why did you get into the CIA, which is obviously a question I get asked a lot. So for me, I am definitely what you would consider very unexpected to have this job. I was born with a condition called hypotonia. I was born in the 70s, so not a lot was known about it. And to be honest, not a lot is even really known about it today. My brother ended up having it too, but mine was more severe. And my mom noticed, I think when I was 6 or 7 months old, that I didn't lift my head up, I didn't try to roll over, I didn't try to crawl, I wasn't really lifting my arms or sort of the trunk of my body, which it's a little unusual that late. So she took me to the doctor, and basically what it is that I just don't have muscle tone like most people do. It takes me a really long time to develop muscle. The doctor said to my mom, you know, she'll be fine. Hypotonia can be fatal, but mine obviously wasn't. But he said, you know, she'll be fine. She'll just always be a person who doesn't walk very well. She'll never be a dancer, you know, and she'll never be really athletic. And so I think, you know, my mom sort of developed the attitude, well, I'll show them. And so my mom promptly enrolled me in dance classes. And she would have to come with me and hold me up a lot of times in the classes. But I guess I sort of bucked the system, and I became a dancer and minored in it in college. That was my thing. I think maybe I just sort of from a young age was always going to defy what people had expected me to be. And so, you know, I was bullied a lot growing up. I'm not really sure why. I don't know that I'll ever know why. But I think I just became really into books and really into school. And I had a high school history teacher that really made history sort of come alive for me, particularly American history. And so I decided, well, that's what I'll major in college. I like it. So why not? So I went to USC and I majored in history there. And I had a professor who had said to me, you know, there's other applications of a history degree. You know, you could work in a museum, you could work for a politician, you could be a lawyer. So I actually tried that. I interned at a museum, I interned for a politician. But one day I was sitting in my sorority house in college and we were watching CNN. Again, a little unexpected, not what I think people imagine sorority sisters to be doing. But we were watching CNN and these two guys, Peter Arnett and Peter Bergen, were interviewing an individual named Osama bin Laden. This was in 1997. I think at that point in time, obviously we know his name now. You know, everyone knows his name. But I think in 1997, there were a lot of questions. Who is this? Is he serious? Do we take him seriously? Where's Afghanistan? You know, a lot of people just, we really didn't understand. And what piqued my interest actually was there was a part in his interview that I still remember where he said that he was declaring war on Jews. And I'm Jewish. And I think for me, being young, I think I was 19, 20 or 20, and I was like, wow, you know, who is this person? Why does he hate my religion so much? And what is that about? And so for me, instead of being put off by what he said, I wanted to actually understand more about why he said what he said. So I started to get interested in counterterrorism. And one day I went to a recruiting fair at USC, and there was a CIA table, and I gave them my resume because I thought, why not? I mean, the worst that can happen, this is something I always tell my students, the worst that someone can happen to you is someone will say no. But the best thing that can happen is that they can say yes. And so I gave them my resume, and a couple weeks later, they called. And I guess sort of the rest is history. You know, I went through the whole process. It took me a few months, and I received a conditional offer of employment. And I started at the CIA really a few weeks after graduation from college. So that would have been May, June of 2000. And I was put in the counterterrorism center. So that's not because I'm fabulous. That is because counterterrorism at that time was not really where the focus of the agency or really even the tasking of the agency was. There was a lot of unrest and things going on in Latin America at the time, Russia we were dealing with too. So a lot of really the seasoned agency folks were working in those divisions, and that's great. And so really it fell to the Counterterrorism Center to have a lot of newer folks in it. And so there were a lot of folks that were around my age, maybe a little bit older, that I was working with. And I started out looking at terrorist training camps. What are they doing? What weapons are they stockpiling? Do they seem to be engaging in any strange training activities? You know, sort of patterns, those kinds of things, and trying to get intelligence on what was going on there. So that's really what I was doing, and that's what I was doing on September 11th. I think because I was at the Counterterrorism Center and because it was this new group, you could advance really quickly. And that was something that was really great about the agency. I don't know if it's still that way today, but at that time I could advance really quickly. And I guess I did a good job at my job because I was selected, three of us were selected to start working on a deeply classified program. And we went and had a briefing about it, and the briefing was on September 10th, 2001. And I think, I don't know that I really thought twice about it. I think I was excited, which sounds so naive now, but I was really excited to be acknowledged for the work that I was doing. It was a really great opportunity. And I remember asking my branch chief at the time, you know, we won't need to kill anyone, will we? And he's like, no, not unless there is, you know, big attack. And obviously, I think everyone knows that September 11th happened the next day. And my life, and really my job life, I guess, changed drastically. I know it might shock some people because we have this image of spies, right? Of, you know, kind of walking around in dark places and jumping out of the shadows. But the reality is while we're waiting to go to training, we all sort of work in a cubicle at headquarters, and we have a very normal job. And so for me, the agency really couldn't afford to have me gone, or really anyone in counterterrorism gone, for 4 to 5 months at a time at the farm. So our training took place, I guess you could say, piecemeal. So I would have like 3 weeks at the farm, and we would do surveillance training, you know, learning how to detect surveillance or even, you know, deter surveillance. Or we would have an outline in my book, which was probably the most fun training to me, which was crash and bang. And that chapter actually was redacted in its entirety, but I petitioned them to let it in, and they did. But that is, you know, it's learning defensive driving techniques, so things like pit maneuvers, how to avoid barricades and roadblocks and things like that. And that was really, really fun for me. I don't know why I liked that training the most, but that was probably my favorite one. And then we obviously have firearms training and some other types of training as well. But my training was sort of woven in the years that I was there instead of just sort of this 1 5-month chunk, which is the normal way. Ours, because of world events, was different, which I think was actually good because it let me have some experiences in between there. So obviously, right after September 11th, I worked on, in my book, I call it The Vault because I can't name the program. It's still classified, so I'm going to call it The Vault during this presentation. It's just easier. So I worked on The Vault program, and that was definitely being thrown into the wolves. So pretty much, I worked about 16, 18 hours a day. You are really working all the time. We weren't allowed to go home. We couldn't have, we couldn't go to see our families on Thanksgiving or Christmas. And I would say every day, there were senators like over my back watching what I was doing, the president, the vice president, secretary of defense. It was a pretty awe-inspiring. I think at the time, I was very caught up in what I was doing, obviously, so I didn't take time to think about the magnitude of what I was doing. Obviously, now looking back and realizing what I did, it was pretty profound. I'll give you kind of one snippet. I was on working that program. I had to talk around it, so I do apologize for not being super specific, but I was on duty, I guess, that night, and it was the night that we lost Osama bin Laden in Tora Bora. And that was a tough night, because we knew he was there, and we were trying to get him, and we just couldn't get the ground troop support that we needed. In a way, it was sort of like a colander, right? You bomb one place, and they all sort of flee, and if you don't have people there to sort of catch the rest as they're running, they get away. And that's what had happened, but it was really being a part of history, being in that room with members of the administration as we're losing Osama bin Laden in the mountains of Tora Bora was obviously a very profound experience. And I think, you feel like a little bit of a failure. It would have, I guess, felt good, I think, to capture him. But I think what that, for me, was a learning moment in that I don't need to catch the big guy to make a difference in fighting terrorism. I think that was sort of a turning point for me. I had always associated it with bin Laden. And the reality is as a figurehead, that he was just that. He was just a figurehead. And so I worked that program for about 5 or 6 months until Tenet, who was the head of the CIA at the time, wanted us to rotate off. He felt that it was just too arduous to be on for 6 months, a year, and I fully agreed with him. So from there, I was sent to the Weapons of Mass Destruction Group, which was a subgroup within the Counterterrorism Center. There's lots of different subgroups within it. And again, that was a new group that was set up. And that was really our job, was to look at Al-Qaeda's development and acquisition of nuclear materials, chemical weapons, and biological weapons. I worked what they call the chem-bio side. So that was your kind of crude toxins, crude poisons, things like ricin, botulinum, germ warfare, those kinds of things, which I actually preferred. I think I always thought that if Al-Qaeda was going to acquire these things, it would be those, not nuclear weapons. So I think I was really doing something more about what I believed in. And I was sent to poison school, which I outlined in my book as well. And that was, they teach you how to make these things, which I know sounds crazy, but I think they wanted you to have that information and they wanted you to have that background so you knew what you were fighting against, which I now appreciate. My target, which it was a guy named Abu Musab al-Zarqawi. Zarqawi later becomes the founder of Al-Qaeda in Iraq, or ISIS, but at the time he was not that yet. He was believed to be, Al-Qaeda in a way is like a franchise, and bin Laden sort of farmed out different tasks to different people, and Zarqawi's job was to acquire those weapons. And so that's why he was our target. And along with some of his henchmen as well. But really, our job was not necessarily to find him. It was more to stop attacks. So it was kind of two different things. We weren't targeting him. We were targeting the attacks that he might start. And so that took me to many different continents. I can't say the exact countries because I already told you why. Mostly the Middle East, Africa, and the Europe region. I'm not allowed to speak about them totally in depth, but you know, we were able to stop one particular really large poison attack. And I can say that it was in a Western European country. And that was a pretty tremendous feeling to be able to do that. We had worked so hard and we had so much great collaboration with this other country as well. It was a really great way to see different countries working together for a common goal. But we also had some tribulations as well. I'll give you one anecdote. We knew that there was going to be an individual that we needed. It's looking like he was probably trying to acquire some ricin for something. And a lot of times these folks, they're not transiting in the United States. They're transiting, you know, in Europe or Africa or these different countries. And so, you know, I'm not going to fly to Europe to get him while he's transiting an airport. That would be very, very obvious. And so, you know, I used my sources in the European country I knew that he had a layover in. And I asked them, I said, can you please follow him while he's on his layover? So one, we know where he's ultimately going. And two, maybe he's doing something during his layover. Could you please do that for me? Which is actually not an unusual request. It's very common. But I remember them writing back, because that's how we communicate, is through something called cables, and saying, we are so sorry, but we're closed and we don't do surveillance on Sundays. And that was really defeating to me because I think I realized that, you know, not every country works like us, and it is what it is. But unfortunately, we lost him after that. He went underground. And that was really, really frustrating. Part of you wants to, you know, fly to that country and yell at them. But you can't do that because you want to continue a relationship with them. So that was something that was really, really difficult for me as well. These are sort of pictures from my time when I was in the Weapons of Mass Destruction group. I can't really say what country this is in, but you can gather that it's the Middle East. In my book, I'm allowed to call it a war zone. And so I did spend a lot of time in this particular war zone. That was a really eye-opening experience for me as well. I think being someone who, you know, my dad was a professor growing up. We never wanted for anything. To be able to see how these folks lived and to gain an understanding of that was, for me being so young, incredibly profound. And I think honestly made me a better teacher in the long run. When I served time in this war zone, I had some really unique opportunities. I was actually able to talk with some terrorists. And what was really fascinating, and in my book, I talk about enhanced interrogation, and I'm very honest about it. But I was able to have conversations with terrorists. And one of them, you know, I asked him, and again, this was another sort of profound moment for me as well. I asked him, I said, you know, why did you become a terrorist? He couldn't have been too much older than me. I want to say maybe he was 27. I think I was 24, 25 at the time. And I asked him, why did you become a terrorist? I couldn't understand why someone would do that. But again, I'm coming from my life of privilege from, you know, Southern California. And I think what he said to me just made it all make sense. And what he said was, you know, look, I was abandoned when I was six. I was living on the streets of the country that he was from in abject poverty, poverty that we don't really even see here in the US. He really had never been to school. He didn't know how to read. He didn't know how to write. He had no food. And he had hepatitis and needed medicine. And Al-Qaeda found him. And they gave him food. They gave him clothes. They sent him to madrasas, which are the religious schools there. They taught him how to read. They taught him how to write. And they gave him his hepatitis medicine. And he's like, I feel beholden to them. Now, I'm not saying that I, you know, will become a terrorist, but that gave me this whole sort of different perspective, on it. And I think it made me realize the why. I wouldn't say it made me realize the why of bin Laden. Obviously, he's a sort of a different beast. But it made me realize the why of some of the other folks, the why they became terrorists. And that was like a really sort of pivotal moment for me. The other pivotal moment for me was, I asked the question, you know, why do you hate Americans so much? And, you know, I think it's a valid question. We all wanted to know. And he said to me, no, it's not Americans that I hate. It's the Jews that I hate. And I, you know, I'm sitting there, I'm Jewish. I know I'm Jewish. And I'm like, do I tell him now or do I not tell him? And, you know, I made a decision not to tell him. I have a little bit of regret about that decision because we developed a rapport, he and I wouldn't say like we were friends, but we developed a rapport. He gave me good information and I treated him with, you know, respect and decency, and part of me wishes that I would have told him at the end that I was Jewish, because maybe he would have had a different experience with a Jew than what he maybe thought they were. Obviously, I'll never be able to go back and redo that, but I think that's a little bit of a regret that I had at the time. And so I spent a lot of time, that's me making friends with a lot of the bomb dogs that were there. We got to be good friends. I really enjoyed them. But you know, it was a really, being overseas in Africa, Middle East, wherever, was really an eye-opening experience for me. And I think it was probably one of the best experiences that I had ever had in my life. Now I kind of want to transition. By 2004, 2005, I was very burned out. Not because, you know, the agency was this bad place, but because I was constantly traveling. I was constantly gone. I was constantly working. And that's just not a pace that I could sustain. And I knew that if I wanted to stay, it wouldn't be a life that was conducive to like a traditional family unit, being stateside. And I knew that ultimately that's what I wanted. And so I did something that was really hard. I left the CIA when I was actually really like excelling. I won the counterterrorism medal when I was there. I received many, many exceptional performance awards when I was there. I received a lot of awards. I don't mean that to sound egotistical, but I think I'm just trying to drive the point home that I was good at the work that I was doing there, but I think even my young age, I was seeing 5, 10, 15 years down, realizing that if I stayed, I'd sort of be stuck in that, and I knew I didn't want to. And that overseas element of the constantly, and I didn't see an end to it. Now I'm hearing that they're on 2 and 3 year rotations, which is better, but I was on, you know, 4 month rotations, 3 month rotation. It was just constant moving. I just knew that that was something I couldn't sustain, and it was something that was very crucial to who the agency was. It was never going to change. And I think I realized that I needed to make a change and I needed to leave. And so I regretfully, I resigned, but in really good standing. I'm still great friends with a lot of the folks who are there, and they've all been actually very supportive of the book. And so I made the decision, and I decided on applying to the FBI because I think I thought, well, the FBI at that time now had a counterterrorism component. And in fact, two agents were assigned to my office in the counterterrorism center, and they were great. They were wonderful to work with. And so I thought, you know what? I can do that, and I can be stateside. And I can be assigned to, I was going to volunteer to go to the LA office, which I knew was either the second or third largest office at the time. And so I decided, I'll go there, I can stay there forever, and I can work counterterrorism. Perfect. I think I was a little naive. So I went ahead, I applied for the FBI. You know, they had to come over to the agency to, you know, interview some of my colleagues, do my background investigation, talk to me. And it didn't take me very long to get a job there because I already had a security clearance, you know, coming from the CIA, so they were able to just grab that. So I started at Quantico. I left the CIA on a Friday. I started at Quantico on that following Monday. And, you know, Quantico is not like what you see on TV. Obviously, I was very prepared. I had done a lot of physical stuff when I was at the agency. That wasn't the problem. I think what was shocking to me was the collegiality. It was very different. At the CIA, I was friends with everyone. I had great relationships with my colleagues, great relationships with my peers, best friends, great working relationships with men, great working relationships with women. It was just a very positive place to be. And strangely, it was competitive, but in a healthy way. You know, we were all kind of in the same position. You know, it wasn't competitive in an unhealthy way. When I got to Quantico, my first day, you sort of sit in a room sort of like this one. It's just where you have your classes. And I believe I was only 25 or 26. So I was the youngest in my class by about 8 years. Average age of starting is about 34. And so, you know, already I was young. And then you go around, you tell everyone, you know, your name, where you're from, and, you know, what you used to do. So, you know, everyone's talking about what they did. We had a lot of people, for some reason, we had like 5 or 6 people that were accountants. We had, you know, someone who's a former police officer. We had former attorneys, computer guys, kind of whole gamut. You know, and then I said I worked at the CIA. I wasn't a classified employee, not thinking anything of it. And it really went downhill from there. Really, everyone questioned whether I worked there, which I found super amusing, given that everyone had to come there to conduct my background investigations. It really just became, there were 34 people in my class, 40 people in my class. 34 were men, and then 6 were women. That was not intimidating to me because, again, you know, I was in a lot of situations, particularly overseas and also in the vault, where I was the only woman, and it really didn't bother me. I never had any issues, you know, working with my male colleagues. This was different. I'm not sure that I'll ever understand the real reason of why I sustained so much venom, but I think part of it is my femininity. I'm extremely feminine. I didn't think that would be a problem. I was very feminine at the CIA. No one cared. And I just carry that into the FBI. And I really refused to change. I think another part, too, was that the leadership at Quantico, my class head, which our supervisor, really could have stopped a lot of it. But unfortunately, and I think still today it's like this, there's a lot of animosity between the CIA and the FBI. The two FBI agents I worked with back at CIA were great. But again, they had signed up to be there. So it was a very different thing. There was a lot of FBI upset because CIA couldn't give them information because they weren't cleared to hear it. Sort of a lot of petty stuff that I think at the time was above my pay grade. But I think my supervisor really came down on me for, I was the target of sort of a lot of it. And it was just a very awful experience. And it caused me to really withdraw during my training. I ate by myself, I studied by myself, I did everything by myself, which I don't think bothered me. I'd spent a lot of time in foreign countries by myself. So being by myself didn't bother me, but it probably didn't help my cause very much, just because folks kind of looked at me as sort of a loner and an outsider. I graduated from the academy, and I was sent to the Los Angeles field office. I think where I was sent also didn't help at the academy. The first part, most people are sent to really large offices at first, and it's to learn the ropes, and that's a good thing. You want to kind of experience everything in your first year as a special agent. But I was sent to a smaller office within the LA office called a resident agency. Most new agents are not sent there. And to be honest with you, I didn't even know why I was sent there. I really just assumed I'd be in the LA field office. And a lot of people in my class had a problem with the fact that I was going to a resident agencies. New agents do not go to resident agencies. But again, that wasn't my choosing. I was sent there. So I was sent there. And I assumed, again, because I had worked counterterrorism at the CIA, I assumed that I would be working counterterrorism at the FBI. I just assumed that they would take, you know, the skills and I could just apply them there. A lot of people ask me why I stayed at Quantico, given some of the pretty horrendous things that I went through. And I stayed because I knew that it was this finite period of time. I knew it was going to be over after 16, 17 weeks. And I knew, at least I thought, that wherever I was going, it would be different. And so I was sent to the Santa Ana resident agency, and I was actually, instead of doing counterterrorism, I did Chinese counterintelligence. And you know, at first I wasn't mad about it. I was actually excited to learn about something new, and I don't think I understood why I was there. And the reason I was there was because of my security clearance. I've come to find out CIA and FBI are two very different organizations. CIA is intelligence gathering, FBI is law enforcement, and that's two different security clearances. At CIA, you have top secret clearance, but then you're cleared to something called sensitive compartmented information, and not everyone at the FBI is. And this was one of those cases that required what we call an SCI clearance. I already had one. And so for them, it was just a lot easier to ship this new agent that already had it to this office. And so it was a really interesting experience. It was sort of earlier on into the case. And this case, I got really lucky. I could talk about it a lot in the book. He's been tried, he's been convicted, he is in jail. CNN covered it. It was in the New Yorker, it's sort of been all over. But it was basically what these guys were doing. Their names were Ty and Chi Mack, and they had interestingly been in the United States for 28 years. They had become naturalized American citizens. And they were working at a defense contracting company that has actually now since closed, but it was a defense contracting company in California. And what that company had developed was something called radar cloaking technology. And it was radar cloaking that I think it was really destined to be used on submarines, but you could also use it on Navy ships, things like that. And it was to make them invisible to radar, which I know that might seem small, but that's actually a huge deal to have that technology, and that's what they were developing. Well, Ty and Chi Mack were shipping it out to China. You know, we had, and we continue to have, a big issue with trade secrets and economic espionage with them, and I just watched this case sort of play out, and it was a fascinating case. The way it was really solved, we got to sort of do everything. It was this really like classic case. We got to do dumpster diving, and of course, being the new agent, I got to do that. And a lot of people think that, oh, that must be so bad. You know, it really wasn't that bad. First of all, it wasn't Dallas, Texas in the summer. If it was, it might have changed my thoughts on it. But you know, it was Orange County, California, which is like 75 all year long. And so I would go, you know, with my overalls and boots and mask and everything into the back of the trash truck. But the problem was, is the trash isn't just from the Mack's house. They have to pull from like a certain radius. Otherwise, the Mack's are going to know if a trash truck sort of pulls up and then drives away. And so I had to discern their trash. And you get really good at it because they disposed of their trash in really interesting ways. They would fold it up in Chinese newspapers, and so all you had to do was just sort of open it up. And this is the letter kind of in the shreds, is how the case was solved. They did all this really, I guess, sexy FBI stuff. We did a surreptitious entry into his home, which is, you know, we had sent them on a cruise so we could go in and see if we could find things, bug his home and put a camera in it. You know, all this really cool stuff that you see on TV. And the way we figured it out was from the trash, like the simplest way that you possibly can. And what this was, obviously I don't read Chinese, but if we see paper written in Chinese, we always brought it back. And we had a analyst who, she spoke and read fluent Chinese. And so this was a tasking letter to the Mack's from the Chinese government, telling them specifically what to get to from Power Paragon to steal. And so that was obviously very cut and dried. And that is what ended up convicting them. I have a picture of myself graduating from the FBI Academy. And then I have Chi Mack's passport up there. And that's ultimately what he was convicted on. his wife and a couple other folks who were complicit in all of this were ultimately sent back to China, which obviously was frustrating because obviously they're no longer in custody. But Chi Mak was sentenced to 28 years in prison here. I don't think he was 71 when we convicted him. I believe he'll probably pass away in prison, but who knows. But so that's the case that I worked at the FBI. I left the FBI, and unfortunately, the reason that I left was because a lot of the same negative situations that I had had at Quantico carried into my division. A lot of the sexism that I faced continued, and to be honest, I just couldn't take it anymore. And I think I was home. I'm from Orange County, California, and so I felt stable and a little bit more confident about leaving. And so I left the FBI, and I thought, you know what? Now's as good a time as I need to be that high school history teacher that I always wanted to be. So I enrolled in my master's program at a school in Orange County, and I got my master's in education there, and I started teaching. And I've been teaching really ever since. But I really think that my experiences are what made me ultimately a better teacher. I taught at Hawk Day for about 10 years. And before that, I taught at a public school, the same public school that I went to in California, and I did my student teaching under the same teacher who inspired me to be a high school history teacher. So it was kind of, I guess, full circle there, which was a really, really cool experience. But at Hawk Day, I started to see that there were a lot of women who really had a lot of questions about these careers, but didn't necessarily see themselves in these careers. In just research I've done and articles I've written, about 19% of the careers in national security are held by women. And that is a very low number. And that's not to say that men are not valuable in these careers. Men are extremely valuable in these careers. I think we need men and women, but we need both. And it was interesting, I was reading an article recently that the head of Mossad wrote about why women need to be spies and sort of some of the traits that they bring to the table. And, you know, they are better listeners, they have more empathy, sort of some of those soft skills that are actually really, really important. But sorry for the digression, but when I was teaching at Hawk Day, I decided to start creating a class on espionage, foreign policy, counterterrorism, so that if they were interested, girls would know how to pursue these careers. And since I've started teaching the class, I've had girls go into those careers, and now it's sort of been parlayed to, you know, being a female instructor who's former law enforcement, you know, teaching at TCU. So I'm really, really excited about that. And so I kind of wanted to, I just gave you sort of my life story, and this is a question I get asked a lot of what I see are sort of the emerging threats or the largest threats. And so I wanted to add this in just in case, you know, I had received any questions on those. And I wanted to give you one from really my personal experience of speaking with that terrorist and what I think is sort of the solution, I guess, to counterterrorism, but also what kind of grows terrorists. And that's something called failed states. I don't think we talk about that enough. So I'm talking, I mean, currently that would be, you know, countries like Yemen, countries like Somalia. Those are countries that can't meet the basic needs of their people. Just like that terrorist, he wasn't having his basic needs met. You know, food, shelter, education, healthcare. People turn to other places to get that. And that could be a terrorist. And I think that's why a lot of times, even if you look at bin Laden and Al-Qaeda, really Afghanistan, you know, where they were born, well, really they were born in Sudan, was a failed state. They moved to Afghanistan, that was a failed state. ISIS, Iraq was a failed state at the time that they emerged. And so I think you really see terrorists growing and flourishing in failed states. The next thing I think is economic espionage. I know that that's a hot topic for today, but that's been a topic for me for 15 years now. And that's because I personally worked it and I saw sort of the damage that was done. So that's what I believe are sort of the two largest threats facing the U.S. Today. Yes, and if you want more about me, you can go onto my website, tracywalder.com, or you can follow me on Twitter. And if you're interested in purchasing the book, in Tarabang, which is a local bookstore here in Dallas, you can get it there. Or you can get it on Amazon or Barnes & Noble. And with that, I'd really love to take any of your questions at this time.
This question is question is from Nigel Watson, and he says, would you have any advice to give to anyone interested in joining the CIA?
So thank you for your question, Nigel. So advice that I would give to anyone to join the CIA, I think a lot of times when I get that question about, you know, how do I join, you know, what advice can you give me? I think a lot of times people are looking for this very sort of one-size-fits-all formula. I was actually just talking with several of my former agency colleagues about this same thing just like 3 hours ago before I coming here. And so I would say part of what I think it's forgotten, you know, we all, a lot of us go to college, a lot of us are outstanding students, a lot of us get degrees. But I think, I think I had just spoken about sort of the soft skills that Mossad was talking about, the ability to listen, critical thinking, empathy, those kinds of things. I think those get forgotten about. And you know, you can really have all these amazing boxes checked, right? You know, a language, a major, a 4.0, you know, all these great things. But then you're sort of missing those soft skills. And that's definitely something I would look at. Also, I think people, you know, they apply to the CIA or want to have these careers at the CIA thinking that it's going to be just like what they see in pop culture, and they go in with sort of this narrow view. So my biggest piece of advice would be to go in with a sort of very broad view, and to be willing to work in any division and any area that they geopolitical area that they put you in, because you really don't get to choose. And the reality is once you get there, it is so easy to move around. Also, super simple thing, subscribe to The Economist. They give probably the best background of the different situations that are going on in different countries and will make you very well versed in many different areas of the world. So I know that was a long answer to your question, but.
This question is from Avery Klunk. I have two questions. Was your family supportive of your wanting to join the Bureau and the agency? Do you have any tips for a teen wanting to go into the FBI? Thank you for coming tonight.
Oh, thank you very much for your question. So my family was, so initially, my mom is extremely traditional, and my mom just always thought I was going to be a teacher. And so when I told her I was going to work at the CIA or that I had, you know, applied and they had called, she was very surprised. And I think originally, it's not that she wasn't supportive, I think she just needed the surprise to sink in a little bit. But I have to say, they were so supportive, and the work that I did was obviously extremely dangerous. And you know, now in my 40s, I look back and, you know, I'm a mom and I think, oh my gosh, would I let my child do this? And I think I have to because my parents let me. So for a teenager right now in particular, particularly a female, one of the best things that you can do is there's a group that I sit on the board of directors of called Girls Security. And it's a nonprofit, nonpartisan organization. And their job and their mission is to bring national security curriculum into classrooms. So I do, you know, curriculum work and things like that with them. They do war gaming at the Pentagon, which is fantastic. They did North Korea last year. And they set young women, grades 8 through 12, up with mentors, female mentors, in the kinds of national security careers that they want to pursue. So if you want to work in the FBI, they'll set you up with a female agent who's currently an agent, or Homeland Security, sort of same thing. So that's definitely a group that I would look at.
This question is from Nigel Watson. This question is from Debbie. What did you think of the portrayal of a female agent in the movie Zero Dark Thirty?
Oh, okay. So thank you for your question. So Zero Dark Thirty. Zero Dark Thirty is an interesting movie. Obviously, I don't watch a whole lot of CIA and FBI shows. Part of it's because I get frustrated as someone who worked there. But Zero Dark Thirty is probably one of the more accurate portrayals that I have ever seen. And the scene where there's the attack at Camp Chapman, that was my former boss who died in that attack. Obviously, they didn't portray her in a way that I felt was, you know, true to who she was. But again, it's Hollywood. I liked that movie because I felt that it was one of the more accurate portrayals of the agency.
This question is from Steve. What happened with Iraq? How did there come to be such an intelligence failure regarding WMDs? Did Saddam have time to move them out?
So that's a great question, Steve, and that is actually the climax of my book. but I'll share it with you all anyways. For those of you that remember, and actually there is a book coming out in a few weeks. Colin Powell was just in the New York, being interviewed in the New York Times about it. And Colin Powell actually does make the correction that it was not an intelligence failure, that it was more of an administration failure. And that's sort of how I felt. So I was working, you have to remember, I was not working Iraq WMDs. I was working Al-Qaeda WMDs. Sadly, two different things. We did not have a Iraq WMD group yet at that time because we didn't predict what would unfortunately ultimately happen. For me, the way I was directly involved in that was that one day a member of the administration had come down to where we worked and saw, so we work in like cubicle bays, and a lot of times to keep track of terrorists, we make charts. It's very common. I know that doesn't sound sexy, but it's just what we do to keep them all straight. And so we had a chart of Zarqawi and sort of his henchmen that were acquiring WMDs. And at that time, there was information out that Zarqawi had transited Iraq. We didn't think anything of it. We knew he had no ties to the Hussein regime. He was simply just transiting. But people had sort of harped on that, so Zarqawi's name kept coming out. It was frustrating to us because we knew that that wasn't correct. So we had this chart. A member of the administration asked for the chart. He was given the chart, and that chart ended up being used by Colin Powell on the floor of the UN, the chart that I made, to tie terrorism to Iraq, which ended up not being true. And Colin Powell actually does, in his interview, take responsibility for that. So I'm very lucky, and that question got answered just a few days ago by Colin Powell himself. But yes, you can still Google the chart. It's there. The chart was originally the Iraq poison chart. But if you Google it online, it does say like Saddam Hussein's WMD. It was really frustrating to us because what had happened was all of the people on that chart, those were targets of ours that we were trying to collect humans on. Obviously, they saw themselves, I'm sure, on TV and went underground. And about 3 weeks later, there was a bombing of some trains in Spain, and they perpetrated that. And I think at that point, I was angry because we felt like we could have stopped that had their names not been out there in the ether.
Thank you for that answer. This caller is from Joe Benick. Do you know Amaryllis Fox? And can you talk about how the preparation of her book differed from the preparation of yours?
I do not know her. Which is surprising because she talks about how she worked in the WMD group, but I actually don't know her. The only thing I can think of is that maybe she came in after I left. I really can't speak a lot about what she went through with her book because I really don't know. And I think that's kind of where I have to leave it. I'm sorry.
I understand. Another question from Nigel Watson. How would you summarize the life of a staff operations officer? P.S. I love reading your book. I think it's another great read up there with the works of Nada Bacos and Doug Law and Robert Beyer.
Yeah, so thank you for that. Nada Bacos is actually a really good friend of mine. She's amazing. And Bob Baer is actually someone I worked with when I was there, and he's amazing too. Doug, I didn't work with. He started quite a bit after I did, so I never crossed paths with him. But two of the three I know and I think are fantastic. So the day in the life of a staff operations officer is hard to answer that question because there's like two different versions of that, you know, pre-9/11, post-9/11. So I'd say pre-9/11, it was very much, I don't want to say 9 to 5, you know, I worked like 12-hour days. You know, you go, you sometimes you have training, because I was pretty new at that point before 9/11. Sometimes you have training, so you're down at the farm for 3 weeks. Other times you're looking through cable traffic, learning how to handle assets, those kinds of things. And then obviously post 9/11, it was constant travel all the time. I don't remember really being home and working in my cubicle a whole lot.
This is from Carol Holman. What was the most difficult thing you had to learn in the CIA and FBI, and why was it difficult to learn this?
CIA is very easy and it's very embarrassing. I talk about it in the book. The most difficult thing that I had to learn, for me, defensive driving was easy. Firearms was easy. Surveillance was fun and easy. Map reading was super easy. I cannot drive stick to save my life. And when I took the crash and bang course, you have to drive stick. And you have to get very proficient with it very quickly. And you have to park tactically, although we have a very uncouth name for it, but tactically, which means back into the spot. And I could not figure out how to reverse the car and stick. So I just gunned it up over the concrete and just parked that way so that it was front sticking out. So that was the hardest thing that I had to learn at the CIA. Everything else was very easy. At the FBI, I'm trying to think. Weapons was easy. Hogan's Alley was really fun. That was more kind of situational awareness. The hardest thing for me was in the PT test, actually, because of my hypotonia. Distance running, I wouldn't say it's easy for me, but it's not as hard because my muscles have time to get working. My fast twitch muscle is like non-existent. So you have to pass a sprint to pass your PT test. And I would say that for me was the hardest thing. And I would pass by like a tenth of a millimeter each time because it was just praying that I would pass that part. So those are the two hardest things.
This question is from Lisa Sams. It's more of a comment. Tracy, I'm a Delta Gamma alumni too.
Hey.
Love reading your story in our magazine, Ancora, and bought your book and read it. Thank you for your service and your willingness to share your story. We live in Allen's neighboring city, Plano, and looking forward to seeing you. Blessings and peace.
Well, thank you so much for that.
And nice this question is from Kevin Hart. How do you justify working for the CIA, given their participation in atrocities such as torture, murder, rape, support of death squads, and running drugs for cartels? This in addition to their normal work of creating coups for democratically elected governments and installing puppet dictators.
So that's a good question, and it's actually a question I've gotten before. I think for me, you know, working, no organization is perfect, and I'm not going to say that the CIA is perfect because I definitely don't think that it is. But I believed in the work that I was doing, and I believed in the mission that I had. And I think for me, I've always had a pretty strong moral compass. I thank my parents for that. And so I believed, and no one around me was engaging in inappropriate behavior. Now, that's not to say that there aren't people that do. I'm 100% sure that there are. But that was just not what I encountered. And I felt that when I was there, I was able to make a true difference, both in my life and hopefully in the lives of others. So I justify my work because I felt like I was legitimately able to stop terrorist attacks. And I was able to learn a lot of lessons and quite frankly, make myself a better person by actually meeting terrorists and talking to them and doing things that other people may not have had the opportunity to do, made me a more worldly person and helped me to really understand those that were attacking us. So that's how I justify it. But I completely understand, you know, your thoughts as well.
Thank you so much, Tracy Walder. And thank you for presenting The Unexpected Spy.
Thank you for having me.